So, we looked at the analyzing the mechanics at the shoulder joint, and in that problem you may have noticed that I had given you many of the dimensions in terms of the body height and the body weight. Okay. So, the mass of the segments, also the muscle insertion points, CG of the segment, these quantities were all given to you in terms of the body weight and height. So, in terms of W and H. Now, there is actually this kind of data is called anthropometric data. Anthropometry is basically a scientific study of the measurements of the human body. So, people have taken done experiments with cadavers or with live people and tried to estimate, come up with some kind of a statistical numbers for these body segment parameters. So, you have, so they define various segments in terms of a proximal point and a distal point. Okay. So, the vertex would be the top of the head. So, the head and neck if you look at it, and the distal end would be your C7 vertebra. So, from the top of the head to the C7 vertebra is your head. Similarly, if you look, thigh is defined from the hip to the knee. Okay. And these segment lengths are all then computed, analyzed statistically for a certain population, and then you have values that you can use. So, this anthropometric data is also very useful as a designer, things to be used by people, right. You want to know, okay, what is a good angle for me to look at, you know, what is the right posture for me to be sitting at when I am looking at a computer screen, for instance. If I am pressing buttons, or you know, how much force can I apply, you know, what distance, what is my range of motion at different joints. Product designers use when they are building things, you know, for this sense. Okay. How much of a push can you exert in what position? You know, if you are sitting, what are the dimensions? When you design seats, how much adjustability should you give, or what would be, how would you design the seat so that a person has the right posture? So, these are the sort of people, and of course, in biomechanics, when you are looking at the mechanics, you need masses, CG locations, moments of inertia of the various segments. So, these are all parameters that you require when you are doing biomechanics, as well as when you are designing products. So, anthropometric data is very useful for these sort of unfortunately, a lot of data that is available is only for a Caucasian population. Like for instance, the Indian population, there is really not a database of anthropometric data available. And as you all know, our body structures are quite different from most Caucasians. So, in many cases, we are kind of, you know, trying to use that data, but which is not, but eventually, hopefully, as more people start working in biomechanics, we will start generating that data for our population. So, for instance, in the US, the NASA is a big, has a big repository of anthropometric data. They need, have these measurements for various quantities. So, in addition to body segment length, you have segmental masses. And again, these are all normalized in terms of the body weight of the person. So, that you can say that if a person has a certain body weight, this is likely to be the segmental mass. So, mass of the femur or mass of the tibia, or actually mass of the hand, because you are actually looking at the whole, you know, with the muscles and everything, not just the bones. Okay. When we talk about the segmental masses, we are talking about their masses as a whole, including all the structures inside, not just the skeleton. Okay. So, when we talk about the thigh, we are talking about the femur, all the muscles, ligaments, etcetera, everything included. Then if you look at the segmental CG locations, these are usually specified as a percentage of the segment length. So, you have the segment lengths, you have the segment masses, okay, and then the segment, the CG location is given either from the PROCOM, then obviously it is at 50% of the segment length. The CG will be at midway between the proximal and distal ends, okay, which is what we assumed for the previous problem. We assumed that both, you know, this is point extended, 0.4 times h. So, this is, so you would refer to such data. So, if some data is not available, so in the previous problem I gave you everything that you needed, all the distances, all the masses. Typically in a real life problem you would not have that data. You would just, you may just know that, okay, this is the external loading for this particular case. Now then I would, from the person's body height and body weight, I would try to estimate, I would go to these tables, these anthropometric data tables, and then find, you know, for the segment of interest, what would be the mass, what would be CG location, etcetera, and then move towards solving the problem. So, everything will not be given to you. You would have to go access that data from the segment definite segmental masses, and we need the insertion points. Those are also part of anthropometric data, okay, that are, okay. So, now we move on to the statics analysis of the spine, the spinal column, okay. We looked at the elbow, the shoulder, and now we are moving to the spine of the body. So, you have seen the structure earlier, you have seen that you have 7 cervical vertebrae C1 to C7. We have 12 thoracic vertebrae T1 to T12 and you have 5 lumbar vertebrae and then the sacrum and the coccyx. Okay, so these form your spine. Now you can see that if you look at each of the discs, you look at, then you see that they get progressively thicker and larger as you move down the spine. Now, the reason for that is they are bearing more and more load as you are moving down the spine. All the load that is above that portion is being transferred to the lower body and to the ground through these vertebrae. So, if you look at, and if you look at the, so what are some of the functions of the spine? So, if you look at the spinal column, it essentially protects the spinal cord, runs through this cavity in the, you have these discs stacked together and each, you know, there is a hole through that and the spinal cord runs through this cavity created by these discs stacked together, okay. So, it protects the spinal cord, it supports the head, neck and the upper extremities, it basically transfers the load, all the proximal loads to the pelvis and you can also, it enables you to perform a variety of movements. With the trunk. So, the vertebrae, these individual units, the bones are separated by what are known as the intervertebral discs. The intervertebral discs are basically fibrous cartilage. You remember when we looked at the type of joints, we talked about these, which allow a limited amount of movement and these basically provide act as shock absorbers. They keep the discs separated and they are flexible, so they act as shock absorbers for this loading and they basically eliminate the, so you can see the discs progressively get larger because larger load is transferred and they act as shock absorbers in this system, shock absorbers, and they reduce bone to bone contact. And so, because they act as shock absorbers, they reduce the effect of impact forces on these discs. Because if you have two rigid bones subjected to an impact force, you could do a lot of damage. So, these discs basically act as shock absorbers. Yeah, it's fibrous cartilage. It's fibrous cartilage. It's okay. So, these are some of the major muscles. So, you have in the cervical spine, you will have neck extensors and flexors, okay, which connect to the base of the skull. Okay, you have muscles that connect to the base of the skull. Then, in the anterior part of the spine, you have the abdominal muscles which help to flex the trunk, okay, both lateral flexion as well as sagittal plane flexion. And then you have in the back, so you, these are all pairs of muscles, you know, here only one side is shown, they are showing one side, they are showing the surface muscles and then the deeper muscles in this figure. And the major muscles in the back are what are known as the erector spinae. So, these are the muscles in the back which are responsible for extension of the trunk and which are basically acting to prevent your trunk from falling forward due to gravity. Okay, so these are your back muscles, they run along the entire length of the spine and that is what is keeping you erect. That is why it is called the erector spinae.
These are always contracted.
These, yeah, when you are subjected to yeah, to the to gravity. Yeah, only in the lying position they would be relaxed. If you are in the standing position to maintain your posture, they probably, because it is a very delicate balance, right? You have such a small base of support, your feet form such a small base of support. So, any swaying is trying to destabilize my body. So, these muscles are what are keeping me erect. Okay. So, sometimes if these discs get affected, so if the spine is subject, why is it important to study the mechanics of the spine, you know. So, we are going to look at bending tasks, lifting tasks, you know, because these are the sort of activities that really load your spine. And why is that important? Why is it important to know how it loads the spine? Because if you overload, or if you subject it, you know, if you damage, for instance, the discs, okay, then you are reducing the shock absorbing capacity. And also if the discs, because the discs are flexible, they kind of bulge out, and then you have the spinal cord here, and then you could actually impinge on a nerve, and that is very painful. So, a lot of back pain happens because of this kind of impingement, because of damage to the discs. You may have heard of slipped disc. So, if the force along the spine is too much, then the disc may bulge out or even slip between two of the vertebrae, and then it starts intruding into the space where the nerves are. And if it impinges or compresses a nerve root, can be very, very painful. The other kind of injury that can happen to the spine is a vertebral fracture. So, the bones could actually crack if there is, in a car accident or something like that. You have heard of spinal cord injuries, right? So, that could be, the vertebra may fracture, it may affect a nerve, and you may lose all sensation, you know, below that region, which, because the signals travel through the spinal cord. So, it is very important that you protect your spinal cord. Okay. So, depending on the level of the spinal cord injury, you could have the consequences could be very different. Okay. If you are talking about the cervical spine, even hand function goes away. Trunk control is affected. So, the lower the spinal cord injury, the better off the person will be, because more of their functions, but anywhere even in the lumbar vertebrae, you lose your lower limb function. Okay. So, everything below that, control of that becomes affected by a spinal cord injury. So, the discs and ligaments, by virtue of their shape, provide intrinsic support to the spinal cord, and the external support is provided by the muscles, contracting around it and keeping things. So, let us start off with the top of the spine. So, you have your head, which connects to the spine by means of, does anybody remember what joint that is? Atlanto-occipital joint. It is the joint at the base of your skull, okay, with the first cervical vertebra. Does anybody remember what kind of a joint it is? That's the atlanto-axial joint. That is between C1 and C2. It's not between the pivot joint. So this joint is actually a double condyloid joint. It is what allows this and this motions in the frontal plane and the sagittal plane. Okay. What you are talking about is the atlanto-axial joint, which is the pivot joint, which allows the head rotation. Okay. So this is the joint, double condyloid joint between the atlas, which is C1, and the it's called the condyloid, sorry, occipital bone of the head. So essentially, you can think of it as a hinge joint for a sagittal plane analysis. So let's see what sort of forces need to be exerted. So again, your head is pivoted. So you have the joint somewhere here. Okay, you have the muscle attachment somewhere here. Okay. Now, I want to know, so I have the weight of the head, say acting somewhere like this. Now, what kind of a lever system does this form? So, the force applied by the muscle would be something like this, okay, be pulling on the back of my head, okay, to keep this is a what kind of a lever is this? It's a class 1 lever. You have the fulcrum, the joint is the fulcrum, so it can pivot about that. So, you need this is your load, this is your effort, right. So, it is a class 1 lever. Okay. Now, so there are 3 forces acting on this body. I have a joint force. There is going to be a joint force at this. There is, I am assuming there is one muscle acting. The muscle is the neck extensor. Okay, I am assuming I can say it is the resultant of all the neck extensor muscles. Okay. Neck extensor is the muscle force that is acting. Then I have the weight of the body. So again, static equilibrium, if I know the, I should know the angle at which this muscle acts, say, oops. So let me give you some, so what do you know about FM? I know the location where it acts and I know the direction in which it acts. Okay. So, this is something I could find from anthropometric data. Then let us say the head weighs 50 newtons, okay, and let us say the CG of the head is at this point C, we know that as well. And let us say FM acts at 30 degrees to the horizontal. Now, I have an FJ. Okay. So, this is a 3-force system. So, I could always also solve it. So, I could use my usual sigma. So, I have, let us say Fj acting like this. Okay. I can do a sigma Fx equal to 0, sigma Fy equal to 0 and sigma m about some point equal to 0. Okay. Or because it is a 3-force system and these forces are not parallel, okay, there is an easier way that I can find the direction of Fj. Because I know the direction of Fm, I know the direction of W. So, I can just the three forces have to pass through the same point. So, my Fj, the direction will essentially become, will pass through along the line joining the point of intersection. So, if this is this and this is j, then my Fj is along this point. Okay? My j, the direction of Fj becomes determined. Essentially, what am I doing when I use the three-force system? When I say they form a three-force system, I am essentially using this equation. I am saying if all the forces pass through a point, then I am basically just using up the moment equation. So, then with this, now I know this angle theta. So, if I have W and let us say I know Fj. So, I can basically just apply these two equations and find the joint reactions and the muscle force. So, then if you can quickly let us say for this particular case, we find out that this is now making an angle of 60 degrees to the horizontal. Okay. So, let us say this is 60 degrees, this is 30 degrees. Okay. Now, can you quickly compute what the tension in the neck extensor muscle will be? Okay. So that is
86.
Okay, 87. So, your neck extensor, again it is just to keep your head erect, it is exerting a tension of about 87 newtons to keep it from falling forward.